Thank you. Good morning. I tell myself to not do that, but sometimes I'll get up really early in the morning and the sermon just isn't sitting right, so I start working on it again. Pray for me. For those of you who are chefs, you understand that. Once you put all the ingredients in, it just doesn't quite taste right, so you got to do something. You know what I'm talking about? Okay. I'm not a chef. My wife does that, so. But we're glad to have you here this morning in a beautiful sunny day. The sun is always shining. Always shining. Just get above the clouds. Get above the clouds and you'll see the sun. Say again?
Liquid sunshine.
Oh, that'll work. Liquid sunshine. Good. Better than moonshine, that's for sure. Yeah. So well done. Well done. Are you happy to be here this morning? Let the person next to you know. Smile. Give them a beautiful smile. Okay, you also eyed a smile. We're glad to be in God's house this morning. We've come to worship Him. And it's very amazing to me. It's raining outside. It'll be a part of our service today, talking about rain, because we want to know what God wants us to know. We have started a series last week on the first of the three angels' messages. Today will be the second. So we pray that God will continue to bless us as we worship Him in this way. Our call to worship reminds us that yesterday was Canada Day. And Canada Day represented the fact that we became independent from that country. And sometimes in our own experience, we forget to remain dependent on God. So when we come to worship Him, we're saying, God, we trust You. We want to stay connected to You. We don't ever want to be independent of You. We want to be interdependent of You. So we've come to worship Him this morning, asking Him to be in our presence, asking for the Holy Spirit so that we can worship Him in spirit and truth. Let us pray. Father, we thank You that we can come here this morning, that we can open our hearts, our eyes, and our ears, that You will speak to us, that You will be with us, that You will always help us to know who You are through Your Word. So we pray today as we open Your Word, as we sing, as we worship, that You will be present, that our hearts will be touched, and that we will know You are God. So please bless us now, and we ask that You will help us to remember You through the words that Your Son taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We want to invite you to stand and sing an important song to remind us what Jesus wants to be for us. Good Shepherd of Your People. Thank you. please be seated. Young'uns. I love it. How are you guys this morning? Good. Have you ever heard the word confusing? Confusion? Would it be confusing to you if one night around 9 o'clock, your mom says, listen, you can stay up all night? Would that be confusing? Maybe. Or it's time to eat. Mom has made a beautiful meal. And she says, you know what? I don't want you to eat it. I want you to eat only ice cream. Would that be confusing? Yep, it would be confusing. Or you see a car coming, and your mom or dad says, listen, the car is coming, run into the street. Would that be confusing? Confusion happens when something is different than what we believe or know is right. So if somebody comes up to you in school and says, listen, when you get into class today, I want you to go up to the teacher and kick him in the shins. Would you do that? Of course not. Would you be a little confused? If the principal had told you that, be a little confusing. Why would he tell you to do something that you know is not right? For us as Christians, the Bible is the only thing that we can trust. We can't trust what man says, what television says, what internet says, what social media says. We got to trust God's Word. Because God's Word is the only thing that will make us right, help us to do right, and follow God completely. So remember, God's Word, we can trust that because God wrote it through the Spirit in using other people to write the words that He wants us to know. So trust His Word, okay? Just like you trust Mom and Dad, trust God's Word, okay? Let's pray. Father, we thank You that we can know for sure what is real through Your Word. Bless these young people that they will continue to grow in You and learn of You, so that when You come again, we will all be ready to go home with You. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, you can go back. Okay, yeah. So, would it be confusing if I said to you right now, the church doesn't want your money. The church doesn't want you to give money. The church will live without your money. And starting next week, come in your bathing suits. Be a little confusing. Mary Lou said, you wouldn't want that. Okay. There are things that are real and are important. And we need to remember those things. Thus, no confusion. Our church needs your giving. This church needs you to return God's tithe and give offerings so that the ministries of this church can go on and on and on. It needs that from you. So never forget that. Sometimes we wonder, I don't know if I can afford it. I want you to trust God. I'll tell you one story I had. When I was newly married years ago, I was in school. My spouse was in school. And I couldn't afford to return tithe. 10% God asks for. So I stopped returning tithe to God for about 3 months. And my heart was get tugged and tugged. And God says, you got to do this. I promised I will bless you. So on a Sunday, I said to God, okay, I'm so sorry. I'm going to start returning 20% tithe. Now, God asked for 10. I couldn't afford 10, but I said to God, I'm going to return 20% tithe. That was on a Sunday. On Monday, I got a letter from my Japanese parents. I was adopted while living there, not officially, but so I had my Japanese parents sent me a letter, and in that letter was a check for $1,000. You didn't hear me. In that letter was a check for $1,000. They had never given me any money before that. They have never given me any money since that. But on that day, that Monday, and it takes about a week and a half for mail to get from Japan to where I was living in Michigan at the time, God spoke to them and said, send him some money. I want to prove to him that I will always take care of him. And I will always remember that. When we return what God asks, it's not for the church only, but it's for your blessing as well. So remember that. Anytime you want to hold back from God, God will bless you when you give. I'm not saying that so I can get rich. As you know, I get paid, what, $50,000 a month here? So it's not for me. It is for you to be blessed because God will continue to bless you. So remember, we have baskets at the back that you can leave your tithe and offerings, and God will bless you as you continue to be faithful. Let us pray. Father, we pray that you will take the offerings, the tithes that are given, that you will bless us, that they will be used to honor your name and glory in this community, and that we will see from your promise that when we return, you will bless. And may your blessings continue to abide in our lives and our hearts. So bless the offerings, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Everyone was singing it internally, including us. So here is our tribute with my tribute.
How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me.
My life, let it be peace.
This morning's scripture reading is Psalm 6. Lord, don't be angry and rebuke me. Don't punish me in your anger. I am worn out, O Lord. Have pity on me. Give me strength. I am completely exhausted, and my whole being deeply troubled. How long, O Lord, will you wait to help me? Come and save me, Lord. In your mercy, rescue me from death. In the world of the dead, you are not remembered. No one can praise you there. I am worn out with grief. Each night my bed is damp from my weeping, my pillow soaked with tears. I can hardly see. My eyes are so swollen from the weeping caused by my enemies. Keep away from me, you evil people. The Lord hears my weeping. He listens to my cry for help and will answer my prayer. My enemies will know the bitter shame of defeat. In sudden confusion, they will be driven away. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you, Margita and Arlene. And thank you, Jim, for reading. Sometimes when we read Psalms, they may sound a bit depressing. Oh, my enemies are always after me. But he always reminds us that God will take care of us. God will be there for us. So today, we continue in the series. Last week, we talked about get ready, which was the first angel's message. Today, we'll be talking about get set, which is the second angel's message. And some of you already think you know what the last title is going to be, so hold on to that. Hold on to that. You'll get a chance to see how well you're ready. But today, we're talking about get set, the second angel's message. Interestingly enough, our eyes don't always tell us what the truth is. So I want you to tell me, what do you see in this picture? Okay. You afraid to say? Say again?
A mountain.
A mountain. Wow. No. That's interesting. That's the first time I've ever heard someone say that. Right here is an old lady. But also you see the profile of a young lady. Do you see that now? Okay, so we have an old lady on over here, her nose, her mouth, her chin. And there's a young lady with her nose profile and her chin. That's what our eyes do. What do you see in this picture? A donkey. Most people see a donkey. Any other animal? A seal. Very good. There's the snout of the seal and the tail of the seal. Victory, defeat is also in there. Very good. Someone got that. So the defeat, D-E-F-E-A-T, inside of the victory. Your eyes, people. Your eyes. Now, this one is slightly different than the first. You all are recognizing the young lady, I'm sure. You recognize the old lady. And of course, we see the old bloke with his mustache. Here, all there, his eye, of course. Our eyes. Keep looking at the plus sign. What is happening? Do you see the circles moving? Yeah? No? They are. They aren't. They're stationary, but when you stare at that plus sign, it looks like they're moving. Are you seeing that yet? You're afraid to say you aren't? It's okay. Okay. That's what our eyes do. So we find today that sometimes we can't trust our eyes in the fact that we need to make sure we have someone who is sure of what's going on. And that's what the second angel's message is all about. But let's get back to where it all began. Just a reminder. King of Babylon, bright morning star, you have fallen from heaven. In the past you conquered nations, but now you have been thrown to the ground. You were determined to climb up to the heaven, and to place your throne above the high stars. You thought you would sit like a king on that mountain in the north, where the gods assemble. You said, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. This is speaking about the king of Babylon, the original king of confusion, Lucifer. In heaven, Lucifer decided he wanted to be the top angel. He wanted to be God himself. And I believe other angels probably spoke to him and says, Lucifer, you're the top angel here, but you can't be God. Stop trying to be God. Be happy with your lot in life. But we know Lucifer was not happy with that. And he continued to bring his confusion in heaven. And with that, a third of the angels were cast out of heaven. And so was Lucifer, whom we now call the devil. He was not happy with his own confusion, so he brought confusion to our world by telling Adam and Eve, you won't really die if you eat of the fruit. Look at me, I'm okay, and I had some of that fruit. And we know what happened. Then God said to Cain and Abel, I want you to sacrifice a lamb. That's the sacrifice that I want, a lamb, the best lamb to sacrifice for your sins. But Cain wasn't happy with that. He wanted to sacrifice what he grew in his own power. He wanted to prove he was good enough. God's plan is God's plan. And confusion has continued in the world. So, into the book of Genesis, we find an interesting story. We touched on it, and we'll touch on it again, because there's a theme that's going through the Bible. There's a theme, a controversy between good and evil throughout the Bible. So we know the story of Noah. He had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. It says that Noah was the only one that was righteous on earth. He had no faults. He was the only good man at his time, and he lived in fellowship. He worshipped God. He trusted God. But everyone else was evil in God's sight, and violence had spread everywhere. That sound familiar? God looked at the world and saw that it was evil, for the people were all living evil lives. God said to Noah, I have decided to put an end to all people. I will destroy them completely because the world is full of violent deeds. This is what God said he was going to do. So Noah went about doing God's work. Noah went about trying to explain to people, listen, there's going to be a flood. God says so because we are not faithful. We are not trusting him. We are not believing in him. We need to make sure that we're ready. So 120 years, Noah preached this message of truth. People at first maybe were concerned, but then they got a little confused and said, well, maybe it's not really going to happen. Maybe we'll be okay. And we know very well what happened. After Noah and his sons and their wives got out of the ark, we know that God inspired Noah, and Noah created a sacrifice. He built an altar and a sacrifice. And God loved this, that Noah would worship him coming out of the ark. As a sign of this everlasting covenant that he made with Noah, I'm going to give you this bow in the clouds. It will be the sign of my covenant with the world. Whenever I cover the sky with clouds and the rainbow appears, I will remember my promise to you and all the animals that a flood will never again destroy the earth. When the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between me and all living beings on earth. That is the sign of the promise which I'm making to all living beings. That was God's promise. And you would think that every time it rained, maybe one or two people would say, okay, we'll see what happens. But there were special people who said, listen, at first the people of the whole world had only one language, used the same words. As they wandered about in the east, they came to a plain in Babylonia and settled there. They said to one another, come, let's build a tower. Let's make bricks and bake them hard so they can... They had bricks to build with and tar to hold. And they said, now, let's build a city with a tower that reaches the sky. First of all, remember, Lucifer himself says, I want to be above the clouds. I want to be above God myself. So here these Babylonians are saying, let us build this tower and reach above the sky. Two or three things are going on here. Where did that water come from that caused the flood? From the sky. So they're saying, if we get high enough, two things. We can figure out where this rain came from. And two, if we're high enough, we will never be flooded again. Na, 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 na. They thought they could tell God what they were going to do. We will be able to do anything that we want to do if we are together in this. Near Iran and Syria, there's still a city. You can see it clearly. Babil, B-A-B-I-L. So they started building the Tower of Babel. And the kids, of course, played with their toys, looking the same. Babylon was a great nation, a beautiful place. Strong, hanging gardens, wonder of the world. But as they continued to build that tower, then the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which they had built. Sometimes we make it look like they hadn't finished it, but it seems they had gotten pretty high up with this. And he said, now then, these are all one people. They speak one language. That is just the beginning of what they're going to do. Soon, they will be able to do anything that they want. Let us go down and mix up their language so that they will not understand each other. Just a little aside, in our day today, people say when you get the Holy Spirit, you can speak in tongues. The word for language is tongues. Even when in the book of Acts, Peter was speaking, the people said, how is it that we all hear and understand in the tongue with which we were born? So, I can speak in tongues. All of you can speak in tongues. Any of you speak a little French? Bonjour. Tout le monde? Tout va bien? You can speak in tongues. Anybody speak Spanish? Buenos días. ¿Cómo está? Bien? 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 Anybody speak Italian? Buongiorno. ¿Cómo stai, Fazan? Croatian. Dobro. Okay. I love languages. I love languages. And, if you don't mind, a little aside, I'd like to figure out where someone is from by just looking at them. And I'm not bragging, but I'm pretty good at it. So I will go up to a person that I know is Japanese, different than Korean, and I say, Nihon no doko kara desu ka? And they're looking at me and saying, man, this guy's English is so horrible, I don't understand a word he's saying. And then I say, doushita no nihongo wa karanai no? Which means, what's the problem? Don't you understand Japanese? And then they hear Nihongo, and they go, oh, hi. And I love that. I'll approach anybody and try to speak in their language, at least a few phrases, just to flip them out. And I tell you, it really works, especially if you sit. One time I was traveling on a train with these people in Japan, and they were talking about me not very nicely, but that's all right. So I waited till I was going to get off the train, and then I walked up to them and started to speak with them in Japanese. They turned red, fuchsia, all kinds of colors. So be careful when you speak about people. You never know if they understand what you're saying. So anyway, back to the story. So God says, let us confuse their tongues. So the Lord scattered them all over the earth, and they stopped building the city. The city was called Babylon, because there the Lord mixed up the language of all the people, and from there he scattered them all over the earth. So what power this nation had. And we know when we looked at the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 2, what was the first world kingdom? Babylon. In that statue, the first kingdom that conquered the world at that time was Babylon. So they were strong people, but now confusion came in. Wherever the Babylonian Empire was, there was strength and power. But God made sure that they no longer had the power to do whatever they want to do. Babylon is mentioned some 260 times in Scripture, second in importance only to Jerusalem. Biblically, Babylon is considered the devil's city, Jerusalem, God's city. They will always be in opposition to each other. In the great controversy, there will always be good. There will always be bad. There will always be those who want to follow God and those who don't. Babylon is the result of apostasy against God's plan of salvation. It was the first international political and religious ecumenical movement in the history of man, and one which has never ceased to exist in one form or the other. God says, do this. Man says, nah, we want to do this instead. God says, do it this way. Man says, nah, we want to do it our way instead. Jerusalem is the result of God's call of a man and a nation to perpetuate his plan of salvation and nationalism for the world. When God called Abraham and the children of Israel, his purpose was not to make them so special that they would go inside a fence and stay by themselves. His purpose was so that they would share God's goodness throughout wherever they went. God's hope for each of us, my friends, is that we share his goodness wherever we are. It is not ours. It is always about God and his goodness. What does Babel mean? Composed of two words, Bab, meaning gate, El, of God. Interestingly enough, the gate of God is what Babel means. And that's what they were trying to do. They were trying to find a gateway up to the gods so that they can become gods themselves. There is a word in Hebrew that's close to Babel, Balal, which means confusion. So every time it rains, there's confusion. I often say, what a job. There's one job in this world that you can always be wrong and still get paid. There you go. There you go. Now, I'm not denigrating men who or women who are weather people, but it's going to rain. Okay. It's not raining. It's not going to rain. Oh, it's raining. Anyway, it's another story. Another aside. So now we find that God is trying to prepare his people for something that is important. And this is the second angel's message. This is the first time that this verse comes in. Yes, forgot this quote. Today it seems that the great Judeo-Christian moral tradition, the most ancient part of our heritage, is crumbling to pieces before our very eyes. The man who trusts a physical science to describe the world finds no conceivable place into which to fit a deity. You would almost think that was written today, but you can see when that was written. In 1929, Professor Randall at the time of Columbia University. James Gilkey also says, liberal Protestants have abandoned belief in the verbal infallibility of the Bible. Sometimes I've heard people say, the Bible is full of mistakes, so why bother? Please hear me carefully. If the Bible has mistakes in it, it can still show you the way to salvation. It can still show you who God is. It can still show you what God wants. It can still show you what the end is going to be, if there are mistakes in the Bible. In his same book, James Gilkey says, this is what a minister said. We believe that Jesus was a human being, that he was born in a normal way. To us, Jesus' death is, in essence, no different from the death of other heroes. Preacher said that. Ancient Babylon was all about confusion. If you can take away God from any situation, and that's what George Washington did in his Bible. You know, Thomas Jefferson wrote a Bible where he took out all of the miracles. Anything that was supernatural, he removed because he didn't believe they could happen. But my friends, if we take away God's stuff from the Bible, we have just a nice book. But in the end, God has something for us in his word. Like the ancient city of Babylon, who rejected God and his directions, who trusted in their own power, who created their idols to worship instead of the true God of heaven, it is said it became a habitation of devils. Every unholy doctrine was found in ancient Babylon. Spiritism, worshiping the spirits of the dead, sun worship, astrology, with all their accompanying evils, were found in ancient Babylon and possibly in modern Babylon today. Are horoscopes more important than trusting what God says? Do we start our day off in God's word or in the paper horoscope section? Babylon. Confusion. But God has a word for us today. He says in Revelation 18:4, come out from among them. Be separate. Come out from her. You must not take part in her sins. You must not share in her punishment. So yes, we may be in a Babylonian experience today, but God wants us to come out of that. God wants us to trust his word, seek his word, follow his word. What does Babylon say? So Babylon says, God, we don't believe your word to be true. Babylon says, you don't need to go to God for anything. Come to us. We will take care of you. Babylon says, we will tell you what God's word says and means. Don't bother reading God's word. We will tell you what it means. We will change God's word and God's law to our liking. We will decide how you will be saved. We will decide who will be saved. So with Babylon trying to take over what God has done and said, God sent the three angels and their messages. Last week, then I saw another angel flying in the high air with an eternal message of good news to announce to the peoples of the earth, to every race, tribe, language, and nation. He said in a loud voice, honor God and praise his greatness, for the time has come for him to judge all people. Worship him who made heaven, earth, sea, and the springs of the earth. And today, we spent time looking at the second angel's message, which says, and another angel followed. Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Babylon is going to fall. We need to make sure we're not in it. As God says, come out of her. It is amazing in the Bible, the church, followers of God, are symbolized by what? A bride. A bride preparing to meet her husband. A pure bride preparing to meet her husband. That's what the church is represented as in the Bible. So on the opposite hand, we see Babylon, which is represented, we still have young ears, as an immoral woman who keeps running after whomever she can in hopes to bring them all to her so that they will enjoy her goods. Babylon is confusion, taking us away from what God would have us to be. It is my prayer that we will trust God. It is my prayer that we will keep seeking after God. It is my prayer that His word will be what we will trust above anybody else's word. It is my prayer that we will continue to learn and grow in Him. What do you believe today? What do you trust today? I'd like to share this song with you at this time. Sound is up.
Song joy, the one that never ends.
And he wants us to be ready to spend the rest of our lives, an eternity with him, because he is faithful, doesn't want anyone to perish. And thus he has given us over and over a message to prepare us for his soon return. Let us pray. Father, we want to be ready for Jesus to come. We want our lives today to mean something in the kingdom. We know in this controversy of good and evil on our world, we have the choice, the opportunity to stand on the side of good. We know that you have prepared us, you have given us your word, and yes, you have warned us. But more so, Jesus, you died to save us so that we will be able to live forever with you. And we thank you for that. We pray for the members of this church, those who are present and those who are watching online, that you will continue to touch their hearts with the word, that you will continue to touch their hearts with the truth, and that your truth will run through our lives so that when error comes, we will know the truth because the truth has set us free. We pray for the upcoming charge that will be coming to the church and his family. We pray that you will prepare them for the ministries that you have for them here, that you will bless the church in unity to stand with and work together to make this community more blessed. Father, we pray for our community, our city, our country, and its leaders. Your word tells us that you allow who you want to be in power. But at times, we don't understand that. But we have to trust that your will be done. We have to trust that you are doing and allowing what will help us to be ready for the soon return of Jesus. So help us to come out of the confusion. Help us to stick with your word. Help us to spend time in your word so that we will know the truth. Father, we pray for those who have been sick and shut in. We thank you that you have been answering our prayers. We continue to ask for your blessing upon Kay Christie, Christine Fullerton, Gail Grandin, Linda Nicol, John Pakuda, Dr. Stuart Plotnick, Ralph Samstedt, Eleanor Sabhani, Edith Tyson. And these are just some of the names that we know. But Father, we uplift all those who are shut in, struggling with health issues, potentially struggling with faith issues. Father, speak clearly to us. Let us know of your mercy and your grace. Help us to know Jesus. So give us the strength to continue on, and may our lives be found in your hands each moment of each day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to invite you to stand and sing our song of faith, Great is Thy Faithfulness. But as for you, continue in the truths you were taught and firmly believe. Remember that ever since you were a child, you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. And now, may the faith that God gives us, the strength that He brings upon us, and the peace that He puts in our hearts be with you always, now and forevermore. Amen.